हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वंस अगेन वेलकम टू दीक्षा मिशन जेआर। दिस इज अ 23rd डे ऑफ दीक्षा मिशन जेआरएफ। इन द पास्ट 22 डेज वी वर डिस्कसिंग डिफरेंट टॉपिक्स कमिंग अंडर एनटीए नेट पेपर 1 सिलेबस। अलोंग विद दैट वी हैव गिवन मोर प्रायोरिटी टू डिस्कसिंग क्वेश्चंस। Especially as of now, we have discussed more than 10 days or 10 videos of discussing previous questions from past NTA NET exams. I hope you are okay or you are clear with the importance of going through previous question papers. Previous question papers helps us a lot in understanding different patterns or the patterns that's been usually followed by NTA or UGC in the past few years. It's very important in some topics like teaching aptitude, research aptitude. Also, it's important in mathematical topics like mathematical reasoning, data interpretation, etc. So, because in topics like data interpretation, most of the question that we see in 2019 December examination is of repeated pattern in nature. Remember, not exact repeated question, instead pattern is almost similar. So in the coming days also, we'll be discussing different questions from past exams. In the last few days, we have been discussing questions from 2019 December exam, that is a latest exam. So yesterday we were discussing the data interpretation question from 2019 December 4th. Today we are going to discuss the next set of questions. At the same time, we are happy to inform you that Diksha Classroom has released a free ebook of NTA NET previous questions of English subject. I hope you will be knowing already we have released an ebook of paper 1 question papers from 2004 December to 2019 June, and the updated version of paper 1 ebook will be released soon, including the 2019 December questions. Also, we have released the ebook of psychology, all the past question papers of psychology, including 2019 December examination question paper, is now freely available. Along with that, yesterday we have released the Diksha Classroom English ebook of previous question papers, in which you have a collection of 30 English question papers from 2012 to the latest 2019 December. So if you are interested in downloading any of this book, remember all these books are available for free of cost. There are question papers and there are also answers. So if you want to download any of this ebook, whether it's a paper 1 ebook or whether it's a psychology or whether it's English, you can visit our website www.dikshaclassroom.com. You just enter the website, you can see those books are available there. You can directly download. At the same time, we hope within one or two days we'll be releasing the ebook of commerce also. Okay, ebook of commerce also will be released within next 1 or 2 days. We are in the final stage of its preparation, and in the future we are planning to release ebooks in many other different subjects like economics, social works, etc. Yeah, depending upon the time and availability of the question papers, we will be releasing all those. All ebooks from the side of Diksha will be of free of cost. Okay, so you can download those ebook from our website. You can utilize those ebooks for your preparation. So that's it, friends. So that's regarding Diksha ebook. And remember, before going to video, don't forget to complete your task number 22. Task number 23, that's a task for tomorrow. So it's in that task, you have to do the next set of previous question papers. Remember, the question paper link is available in the description. Or if you want to receive the question paper directly from our WhatsApp, If you want to receive the link of all Diksha Mission JRF videos, link of previous question, link of 2019 December previous question. As of now, we have released 6 parts of 2019 December previous question. The remaining will be also released in the coming days through the YouTube. So if you want to get link of all those videos and the link of ebook, etc., you can join our free paper one broadcast by sending join to 9847478690. The format and the phone number is also given in the description. So don't forget to do your task number 23, next set of question papers, which is available. The link is available in the YouTube description. The answer key for yesterday's question paper is also available in the YouTube description. Okay, so that's it. That's all about task number 23. So definitely directly we'll be going to the questions from this video. In this video, we are going to discuss the question from People, Development and Environment of 2019 December examination. So friends, let's go to the question. Hello friends. So as we have already said, we are discussing the 4th December 2019 morning shift questions. In this video, we are going to discuss question from People, Development and Environment. Let's go to the question from People, Development and Environment. So this is the first question. The most dominant source of benzene emission in ambient air is. So this is a question from the topic air pollution that comes under our environment syllabus. So the question is, the most dominant source of benzene emission in ambient air is. There are option givens are cement industry, cigarettes, car exhaust, paints and varnish. Okay, that's it. They are the options. So give me the answer. I will give you some time. Okay, so that's it. The answer is, it's an easy question. It's a direct question. It's a factual question. The answer is car exhaust. Because as for many scientific studies, we can see that most of the benzene emissions are coming from the automobiles. Because especially the benzene is emitted by motor vehicles through volatilization losses during the vehicle filling operations. And as per many studies, almost 60% of the total benzene released in the environment comes from car exhaust, or more specifically automobiles. Okay, not exactly car, so automobiles. So since car is one of the most significant automobiles that's present in our days, so we can say car exhaust. So that's it. It's a direct question. We have car exhaust as the answer for this particular question. So moving to next question. Identify from the options given below the co-benefit of Montreal Protocol. So the question is regarding the co-benefit of Montreal Protocol. We have discussed regarding Montreal Protocol in environmental preservation efforts. And the option given by them in this question is impetus to the development of energy efficient systems, reduction in carbon dioxide equivalent emissions, convergence of efforts of international community in addressing air pollution, control of transboundary movement of hazardous waste. So give me the answer. Try to give me the answer. Okay, I will give you a few more seconds. Question is regarding not the direct benefit of Montreal Protocol instead. The question is all about the indirect benefit. Okay, so that's it. We'll try to give the answer. I hope you will be knowing what is Montreal Protocol is all about. So, because the Montreal Protocol, Montreal is a place in Canada. It's a protocol or it's a global agreement that aims to protect the ozone layer by phasing out the production and consumption of ODS or ozone depleting substances. So the main benefit or main aim behind the adoption of Montreal Protocol was the phasing out of ozone depleting substances. But an important core benefit of this one is that as a part of this, when we reduce the production of or utilization of ozone depleting substances, there will be a reduction in greenhouse gases also. Okay, greenhouse gases also, because most of the ozone depleting substances through reactions and as a byproduct releases greenhouse gases like carbon dioxide, nitrogen dioxide, etc. So even though the direct benefit or the direct aim of Montreal Protocol was reduction of ODS, it indirectly co-benefited the reduction of greenhouse gases also, because these substances, okay, on combustion or utilization of these substances or byproducts released were certain greenhouse gases. So that's the reason they ask co-benefit. So we have the reduction in carbon dioxide. It's a bit distinct question, because normally we'll not associate greenhouse gases with Montreal Protocol, but we can say it's a co-benefit of Montreal Protocol. So we have option B, reduction in carbon dioxide equivalent emissions, as a correct answer. Moving to next question. Under Green India Mission, how many hectares of degraded forest land is to be brought under afforestation? So there is a particular mission of Green India Mission, and the question is, as per this mission, how many hectares of degraded forest land is to be brought under afforestation? Options are 2 million hectares, 6 million hectares, 8 million hectares, and 20 million hectares. Okay, so that's the question. Okay, so that's it. We'll be discussing the question because it's a direct factual question. Before answering the question, let me discuss a little about National Green India Mission. I hope you would have heard regarding NAPCC or National Action Plan on Climate Change. Okay, it's a particular document or a particular scheme released by the government of India in 2008 with the purpose or with the objective to mitigate and adapt to the climate changes in different domains. So NAPCC or National Action Plan on Climate Change, remember NAPCC is directly mentioned in our paper one environment syllabus. So it's a scheme so as to adapt to the climate changes in different domains. As a part of NAPCC, we have 8 missions. Okay, as a part of NAPCC, we have 8 missions, and there is a, I hope you would have heard, there is a national solar mission regarding improving the utilization of solar energy after NAPCC. Or so we have 8 mission, national solar mission regarding solar efficiencies. Then we have the national mission or national water mission. You have a national water mission improving the efficiency of water usage. Then you have national mission on sustainable agriculture. Then you have national mission on strategic knowledge for climate change. Then you have national mission on sustainable habitat. Then you have national mission for sustaining Himalayan ecosystem, and you have national mission on enhanced energy efficiency. And finally, you have National Mission for Green India. Okay, there is no particular order. You can say National Green India Mission in the first or second position also. So these are the different missions coming under NAPCC or National Action Plan on Climate Change. So there are 8 mission: National Solar Mission, National Water Mission, National Mission for Sustainable Agriculture, National Mission on Strategic Knowledge for Climate Change, National Mission on Sustaining Himalayan Ecosystem. National System on Sustainable Habitat, Himalayan Ecosystem, National Mission on Enhanced Energy Efficiency, and National Green India Mission or National Mission for Green India. Okay, so that's, so you have to study regarding all this mission. There are 8 mission. We have already released document or study material on that. So as per National Green India Mission, there is a statement regarding increasing, the forest area, or bringing forest area under afforestation to a minimum of 6 million hectares. So you have the option 6 million hectares. Remember, it's a part of National Green India Mission, which is a part of one among the 8 mission of National Action Plan on Climate Change. Remember, National Action Plan on Climate Change is an important aspect for our exam. Go through it. So moving to next question, question number 44. The most important pollutants that cause degradation of water quality in rivers and streams are? So that's the question. The most important pollutants that cause degradation of water quality in rivers and streams are? So you have the options as bacteria, nutrients, metals, total dissolved solids, and algae. So try to give the answer. I will give you some time. You can comment your answers in the comment box. So the question is, the most important pollutant that cause degradation of water quality in rivers and streams are? Okay, so the question is, the most important pollutants that cause degradation of water quality in rivers and streams. Okay, so the question is regarding pollutants. Okay, we have the option as the correct answer. We have bacteria, nutrients, metals as the correct answer. It's because the water quality, the reason is that water quality, when we analyze the water quality, we can see that it is measured by several factors like the concentration of oxygen, bacteria, amount of salt, or the amount of material suspended in water, etc. So the confusion you will be having here regarding the question is that how this nutrients comes under a pollutant. So basically it comes under a pollutant because too many nutrients in the water can cause excess growth of certain aspects, okay, excess growth of certain microorganisms, which will further increase the pollutants available in the system. Okay, so we can say bacteria is a part, nutrients is a part, metals is a part, and also total dissolved solids as well as algae. Okay, definitely algae will be also a part. So I hope firstly I told the answer. Yeah, answer is you have answer for. Okay, total dissolved solids is a part, bacteria is a part, nutrients is a part, metals, total dissolved solids, and algae. Okay, all comes under what we can say. Pollutants that cause degradation of water quality. So all these aspects, okay, all this except comes under a part of pollutants. So metals like nitrate, cadmium, etc. causes different diseases itself, like blue baby syndrome. Similarly, blue baby syndrome, after blue baby syndrome, we have cadmium ittai syndrome, Minamata syndrome, etc. So so in this aspect we can say the answer is all of them. Yeah, B, C, D, and E, bacteria, nutrients, metals, total dissolved solids, and algae also. Okay, for this question we have the option A, B, C, D, and E as the correct answer. Option for A, B, C, D, is the correct answer. So moving to next question. 45th question, the themes of some sustainable development goals are. So the question is, which among the following are themes of sustainable development goals? So that's the question. It's a question from sustainable development goals. Okay, give me answers. They have given six options: climate action, sustainable cities and communities, peace, justice, and strong institutions, skill development and decent employment, green agriculture, responsible consumption and production. So you want give me the answers for which among the following comes under sustainable development goals. Okay, so that's it. Let's try to discuss the answer. The question is regarding the themes of sustainable development goals. So I hope you know what is MDG, Millennium Development Goals, and Sustainable Development Goals. Millennium Development Goals are a set of 8 goals adopted by UN in 2000 with the target year of 15 years, that is 2015. So set of 8 goals with a different target that has to be followed by, fulfilled by all the member countries. And by after the end of Millennium Development Goals in 2015, UN introduced the Sustainable Development Goal in 2015 with the target of again 15 years. So the target date is 2030. So it's a set of 17 goals that has to be fulfilled by the member countries. Okay, so there are different goals. I hope we would have discussed already regarding this aspect, and you will be knowing Millennium Development Goals and Sustainable Development Goals directly mentioned in our environment syllabus. It's very important. So we have 17 goals, sustainable, 8 goals with regards to Millennium Development Goal. So important sustainable goals are no poverty, not important, the complete sustainable goals are no poverty, zero hunger, good health, quality education, gender equality, clean water and sanitation, affordable and clean energy, decent work and economic growth, industry, innovation and infrastructure, reduced inequalities, sustainable cities and communities, responsible consumption and production, climate action, life below water, life on land, peace, justice and strong institution, and finally the partnership for goals. Okay, so partnership for goals. So we can say climate action is one among them, then sustainable cities and communities. Okay, sustainable cities and communities is a part of that. So we have a sustainable cities and communities, then you have peace, justice and strong institutions are there. We can say that skill development and decent employment as a part of this one, and also there is no concept of decent employment in sustainable development goal. Also there is no green agriculture, but there is responsible consumption and production. Okay, so we can say there is a responsible consumption and production. So we can say 1, 2, 3 and 6. Okay, so we have option D, 1, 2, 3 and 6 as the correct answer. So that's all about this set of questions from 2019 December 4th morning shift, people, development and environment. So friends, that's all about this video discussing question from people, development and environment and higher education system. Okay, so in the coming videos, we'll be discussing other questions also from these exams. I hope you are clear with the questions. If you have any doubts, you can ask in the comment section. We are happy to know that our videos are helping you a lot. Definitely do share with your friends. And if you are interested in knowing more about Diksha online courses, Diksha mock tests, etc., you can visit our website www.dikshaclassroom.com. So friends, see you tomorrow, same time. Thank you.